actually, in my opinion, are to my favorite panel, which is a supply chain. They're the ones who can tell you what it actually takes to get past those challenges they've experienced, what they've had to do to overcome, and to stay strong and competitive in this marketplace. I do want to say thank you once again to this final panel. I want to note, taking nothing away from the city of Los Angeles, the city of Torrance is, in my opinion, a best practice example of how to work collaboratively and proactively with your business base. One of the few cities I know who on a regular basis go out and visit their companies, not just the retail, but their industrial base, their manufacturing, because they recognize the importance of that industrial space. So I really appreciate the mayor being out here. Appreciate Abe talking about M&A. I appreciate my colleague, my talkative colleague, Tomas, talking about strengthening competitive programs. And of course, Aaliyah talking about export development opportunities. At this point, I'd like to call our panel, our last but not least panel, up to the stage to talk about our supplier chain competitiveness. You guys can come on up. Our host for this particular panel is none other than Camille Geiger, who we have happily reached out to again this year because she was one of our panelists last year speaking from the OEM's perspective. Now she is hosting the suppliers to talk about what they have done successfully to overcome challenges and can maintain their competitiveness. As they're coming up, I did want to say someone mentioned additive manufacturing certification program. We have one at UC Irvine that's about to start. So if you are interested in additive manufacturing, it's an executive level program so that you as an executive within your manufacturing company can decide whether it's something that you should go into and look at the cost-benefit analysis. So we definitely want to make sure that you know about that. And also, everything today has been videotaped. So all of this afterwards, we were going to post onto our website along with all of the PowerPoint, so you don't miss anything. Just want to make sure you all know that, okay? Without further ado, Camille Geiger.
Thank you, Libby, for that nice introduction. So as Libby said, I'm Camille Geiger. I have the responsibility for supplier diversity and economic development for the Boeing company, primarily on the Boeing defense side of the business, but I also am the company SBLO, and I work very, very closely with our commercial Boeing group, as well as our shared services group in AT&T group, which is our engineering, technology, and transition team. So first, what I'd like everybody to do is just stand up for just 1 minute. I know everyone has been sitting for a while, and there's a great group of small businesses here who are gonna share with you their stories. I've reviewed the presentations. They're phenomenal. So I just want everyone to get like a little energy going, right? It's been a long day. There's a lot of information going through, and we're all trying to digest it. Okay. So let me just give you a couple information about the structure here. So what we're going to do is we have a quick video that we're going to share with everybody. It's an inspiring video on some of our space programs. I think you'll find it very informative. Scott provided it over to me and said, hey, this might be something cool to share. And I said, absolutely. I thought it was great. So we're going to share the video, and then I'm going to do a quick introduction to each of our panelists, and then we're going to go forward with our presentations.
Kennedy said, quote, the other things, go to the moon and the other things. And we are finally at a point through the evolution of the Orion spacecraft and the SLS that we're taking that next giant leap for all mankind that Neil was talking about.
The one thing I've always thought of with Mars is when they describe it as the planet that's most similar to Earth, which of course makes you think, well, it sounds like that's the first one we should visit.
It's essential that we go and find out what is out there.
There's a rocket out there. It's all over the country, and the pieces are going to come together soon from New Orleans and from the West Coast and from the East Coast. those pieces are going to be assembled there at the Cape, and we're going to launch. Incredible the number of pieces and people that touch a spacecraft before it goes in orbit. It really is America's space program because so many people touch every vehicle.
One day, we'll be able to look up into the night sky and know that humans are living on another planet. But getting there won't be easy. In almost every state in our nation, thousands of men and women are hard at work creating the world's largest rocket. The world's first crewed deep space spacecraft and the only and most advanced infrastructure capable of launching humans into deep space.
The thing that I found out about the space program is the incredible pride that all the people making parts for it have. It's important to get around to all of these vendors to see the pieces and the people that make those pieces.
As the mayor of the city of Cerritos, I see firsthand what these programs will do for a city.
A lot of these places that build things, they're like the cornerstone of their community. They're one of the big businesses in their community, and they're keeping those small communities thriving. Think about taking humans off of our planet and putting them on another planet, Mars, for the first time. It's just incredibly exciting to me.
It's happening now. We have begun the journey to Mars.
So we might be the last panel today, and I would never say that we were the best after Petraeus and Mr. Shaw spoke this morning and all the other great presentations that we've had, that we've seen today, which was phenomenal information. But I will say you're going to be glad that you stayed till the end and make sure you tell all your colleagues who left what they missed. All right, so let's get started. First, I'd like to introduce and I'm going over my notes right here, Kellie Johnson. Kellie Johnson's the president of ACE Clearwater. I'm just to save time, I'm not going to read through her complete bio. It's in your books. But I would like to say that she sits on many, many manufacturing councils, and she's an advocate for small business, an advocate for manufacturing. And one of the things that we're always asking our suppliers at the Boeing Company is to be an advocate, because we consider our suppliers partners. So you heard a little bit about Ex-Im Bank. Very, very important. And as we advocate for those issues, that we expect our suppliers to partner with us. So I want to say thank you for that. And also, I just have to give a shout out to another fellow Trojan at church. You know, we might say, give me an amen, but when you're in USC territory, you say fight on, so.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so very much for staying to the very last panel. I really, really appreciate it and appreciate the support from my entire panel and Camille, and for the invitation from AMP SoCal and USC to be here today. As Camille said, I'm Kellie Johnson. I'm president and CEO of ACE Clearwater. We're a supplier to the aerospace industry and power generation industries. And this slide is a really good example of the kind of parts that we make. It's representative of commercial, of defense, of power generation, and of space. And it really showcases all of our capabilities. ACE Clearwater, I wish Mayor Furry was here. I wasn't on one of his slides. We're headquartered in Torrance. So next time he gives a presentation, I hope to see ACE Clearwater up there. ACE Clearwater employs 200 of the best men and women in our industry. We build to our customer specifications. We don't have our own proprietary product. So we used to be a job shop. We used to build to a blueprint. Now we build to data. Our core competencies are in the forming and welding of exotic materials, but we're a fully integrated enterprise. An example of a part that we're building directly for the government is the primary nozzle that goes on the Apache helicopter. You can see where it's installed, where the red circle is. We like to say that this part actually diffuses the heat from the helicopter, and the pilot actually gives off more heat than the engine, believe it or not. Another part that we manufacture, this is an APU assembly that we build for Honeywell that goes on the 777. And you can see in the background the 3D model on the monitor. We printed a prototype so that we could have discussions with the engineers before we were awarded the part. And when we were talking about reducing piece count, and then the final product right in front of you there. This is a lot of information on the slide, so I'm not going to go through all of it, but Ace Clearwater is a third-generation manufacturer. It was started by my grandfather, Ray Wyckoff, in 1949. He actually learned the welding trade in a government work program during the Depression. We were incorporated in 1961. After the Korean War, my grandfather moved the family from Oklahoma to California. We like to think it was sheer oaky luck that he did that, but like so many people, he was coming to the Golden State then. He did get lucky and moved to El Segundo, which we like to think of as the epicenter of aerospace at the time. My dad bought the business from him in 1970, and my dad was truly the entrepreneur. My grandfather, I think, thought he was just going to make ends meet by repairing things by welding. My dad, when he bought the company, he realized that by acquiring more capabilities and becoming a vertical enterprise, we'd have the opportunity to bring more value to our customer and get involved in more complex assemblies. So over a course of time, we acquired two bending shops and machine shops, little by little. And then in 1982, we acquired Clearwater Tool and Die. Clearwater Tool and Die has been a drop hammer forming operation since the 20s. And we used to buy our details from Clearwater Tool and Die. And as was mentioned earlier by Tomas, it was one of those situations where the family didn't have a succession plan, and basically they were closing the doors. So my dad acquired Clearwater Tool and Die, which allowed us then to really possess all of our capabilities under one roof by the ability to form the metal and machine it and weld it. We had all of our capabilities under one roof, which really gave us a competitive advantage, and that's what differentiated us, I would say, from our competitors. You know, over time, we started clustering capabilities. So for example, we'll design our own tools. We have our own foundry where we can pour the blocks, we can machine the dies, and then we can produce the hardware. I actually became president in 1988. So I'm one of those gray hair ladies, except I just had roots touched up recently, so hopefully it's not so bad. I was the first one in my family to go to college. And like most young people, I wanted to make a difference in the world, and I wasn't really quite sure what I wanted to do, so I studied international relations and political science from USC. I realized that the chances of me getting involved in foreign service was a really long stretch, and to become an ambassador and throw fabulous parties in Italy probably wasn't going to happen. So I thought, well, maybe I could change the world and help people on an individual basis, and I applied to a master's program in clinical social work. And all the while, I was working at the company. And one day, I was standing out in the parking lot, and I saw all of these new cars. And I thought, wow, our little family business is allowing people to buy new cars and put their kids through school, buy homes. What better reason for me to stay in this business, to continue a family legacy, to provide these amazing careers, and support an industry where the United States is still the global leader? So I became president in 1988 when Boeing was going through a strike, and they completely saturated the Southern California supply chain. And most of these parts, as you know, had never been built outside of a Boeing factory. The tooling that we were receiving was in bad shape. We had never built it. We basically doubled in size overnight. And I'll never forget the conversation. Two Boeing directors sat me and my dad down in his office and said, unless you put someone of ownership on our program, you probably won't ever do business with us again. Next day, I get a call from our buyer and said, congratulations, Mrs. President. So the journey started, and I'm really proud to say that in 1993, we were awarded the Boeing Supplier of the Year for purchased outside parts. Yahoo! Over time in 2000, we became AS9100 certified. We acquired the Honeywell metal forming facility in 2002. We began our sustainability initiatives in 2005. We became NADCAP approved in 2007. And in 2012, we started acquiring advanced technologies and disruptive technologies that we're currently using in our operation. An example of a game-changing, I would say, capability. We could attribute our success to the businesses that we bought, the capabilities that we bought over time. But if you have access to capital, it's pretty easy to go and get a building or to buy a new piece of equipment. But what we found to be our biggest game-changing capability, it was our ability to manage complexity. Because as an aerospace supplier, we work, it's low volume, high mix. You know, it's very complex. And so the ability to manage both development programs and legacy programs can be very difficult. And here is an example. The part that you see in front of you is a CO2 scrubber for the space station. It's a 46-week lead time item. It's really long. It's very complex to make. The space station had a hard launch date to deliver some supplies, and they came to ACE because they had two failures at the space station, electronic failures, and they needed to have those replaced. Luckily, we had some parts in WIP, and we had about 25 weeks left to go, and we were able to get that down to 42 days. And you think, how are you able to do that? We are able to do that with this amazing team. And that's what I'm here to talk to you guys about today. It's the people of ACE Clearwater that give us our competitive advantage. They're amazing. They are committed. They are engaged. They are willing to go the extra mile. We work 24/7 to make that happen. And as a reward, we had an astronaut come and visit us, Robert Behnken. And he took the time to share with us his missions, took pictures with us, and signed autographs. And, you know, we were able to create a team like that because we are really big supporters of training. Many, many years ago, the thought on the shop floor was, if I know this process and no one else does, then my job is secure. But as all of you know, our industry goes through, you know, cycles. And so we really broke down that barrier and helped people understand that the more they knew and the more tasks that they could be competent in, the more value they'd be bringing to the company and to themselves. So we started a big cross-training program many, many years ago. And to this day now, we train 500 hours or more per year per employee. We pay for all of their tuition up front. You've all heard the saying that what if we train them and they leave? What if we don't train them and they stay? So we embrace that, and we are able to, you know, we have a really, really great culture. It's management by walking around. But we're entering a new cycle now. As you can see, the backlogs of Boeing and Airbus are going through the roof. If you were to look at the trend in our backlog, it's the same thing. Our quote capture rate is just going through the roof. Our customers are taking us from building simple components that you see over on the left, details, into major assemblies. So in some ways, they're really stretching our capabilities in addition to the volume that we have. And now our president is talking about taking defense spending to historic levels. So, I mean, this is all really great, and it's really good opportunities for those of us in the room. But where are we going to find the talent that we need to compete and to win these opportunities? The Manufacturing Institute and Deloitte published a report that says over the next decade, there will be 3.5 manufacturing jobs needed, and probably 2 million will go unfilled because of the skills gap. Long ago, we saw the writing on the wall. I would say back in 2004 was when I really started advocating for manufacturing, talking to the public about what modern manufacturing is all about and trying to change the outdated perception that so many people have. In addition, we started forming really good partnerships with schools, middle schools, high schools, community colleges, trade schools. Because we saw the writing on the wall. Our society was telling everyone in order to succeed, you had to go to a four-year college or university. We recognize that manufacturing is the engine that has created the middle class. It's what drives our economy. So what are we going to do about it? We started early on developing those partnerships with the schools. We have internships that are paid for programs at our company. We tour students through our factories. We host Manufacturing Day. The first Friday in October every year is Manufacturing Day. This past year, we had over 700 students go through our factory. We work with USC and their engineers, or their senior engineers on their senior projects. We do six of them a year. So we laid the groundwork and established those partnerships way early on when we saw what was happening. But this is the situation we're in today. You can see the number of open positions we have, the time it takes to fill them, the ones that we hire, how many we're actually able to retain. And if you look at the chart, that's just our technicians on the shop floor, the men and women on our shop floor, and you can see that the majority of our employees fall between the ages of 45 and 65. So what we were doing before wasn't working. We created a great culture. We reach out to our communities. We sponsor many different activities. We put kids through kicks through these soccer programs. We sponsor detailing Air Force One. We give to charities over the holidays. We host parties. We really wanted to create a culture that we could retain these folks because we're in a unique position. Base Clearwater, as a small company, we're competing for the talent, and competing for talent right now is fierce, and we all know it. But we're competing against really small shops that only need one or two key players, and we're also competing against very large companies that perhaps can provide better benefits than what Ace Clearwater can. So we realized we had to do something different. We embraced social media. I really encourage all of you to check out our website. We've just redone it. It's really awesome. And Facebook, believe it or not, we actually have a director of communications in our small company that handles both internal communications and external communications. And in fact, one of our most recent hires was a program manager. She saw what we were doing on Facebook with the charities at the holiday times and said, that's the kind of company that I want to work at. So I would I cannot stress enough the importance of the cultures that you're creating in your enterprises. And lastly, I'm just going to end it with the new initiative that we're launching. It's called Makers Nation. My husband Gary and I believe passionately that there's something very important about our ability to make things. And it might just be the classic American notion of security and prosperity and freedom. But we want to create a social media environment for the men and women that are in manufacturing so they can further their careers, they can network with each other, and they have a safe place to share what they do every single day. Because what the men and women do in our factories every day truly protect our nation, strengthen our economy, and improve our quality of life. So thank you very much.
And one of the things I'd like to point out here is that we, between Boeing and our businesses here, we all have something in common, which is we all began as small businesses. So each one of these businesses is continually developing, and we're going to hear more about that. But we never forgot the fact that we started out as a small business, and as you said, it is the innovation and creativity and the ability to adapt. Because at the end of the day, we as businesses can disrupt or we can be disrupted. And so we need to think about that as we're moving forward. We saw the SLS, it'll probably launch in 2018. And so keep that in mind. Next, I'd like to introduce Mike Riley. Mike Riley is the CEO for AMRO Fabrication. Again, you can read his bio, but I just wanted to share that AMRO has the distinction of actually being a Boeing mentor protege. And so we're really excited about that. Anybody who's ever had a mentor protege agreement with a large prime contractor understands that it's not easy. It takes a long time. There's a lot of requirement from the government customer, and you have to develop a very strong relationship. One of my former colleagues used to say that if you're not prepared to take your protege home for dinner on Sunday night, maybe they're not the right protege, and that's true. You spend a lot of time. So with that, Mike.
Thank you, Camille. So Tomas made a comment about hearing from a young firecracker who's looking to take the family business to the next level. I'm still trying to figure out whether he was talking about myself or Kellie. But my name is Mike Riley. I'm the CEO from AMRO Fabricating. Thank you all for being here this afternoon. We're excited to be here and have this opportunity from AMP SoCal. Like Ace and Kellie, AMRO was founded by my grandfather in 1977. So I'm proud to be a third generation member of the AMRO family. We are a certified small minority woman-owned business. We have seven buildings totaling 300,000 square feet. Six of our buildings are in the South El Monte area, and one is at the March Air Reserve, where we work closely with the March JPA. We currently have 200 employees, and we are a supplier of metallic structures and tooling to the aerospace and defense markets. So what we do, our core competency is spaceflight hardware. So we support NASA, Boeing, Lockheed, ULA with metallic structures. Here in the picture to your right, two years ago, we had this opportunity where we actually had every piece of metallic structure from the engine section all the way up. It's hard to see, but all the way up to the top to the Orion crew module. So so if you were to look at a stack up of SLS there in our alley in South El Monte, you'd basically see a piece of every barrel section on the SLS rocket all the way up to the Orion crew module. So that was an exciting time for us. The other part of our business that we do is we design and build automated and conventional tooling, once again, in support of commercial and military aircraft. Finally, we also invest heavily in research and development to ensure that we are always utilizing the latest technology, machinery, and we are always working with our customers with the latest materials and processes. So this is another view of the SLS rocket, and the panels that we manufacture that are depicted in this view here range from 12 feet wide to 24 feet long to 12 feet wide by 12 feet long. And what we do is we machine these. So we take essentially a 14,000 pound plate, aluminum plate. We machine it down to roughly 300 pounds, and then we form it to the contour. And we ship the pieces to the NASA Michoud assembly facility in New Orleans, and they put the barrels together and weld them and stack them. Here's another piece of spaceflight hardware that we manufacture for the Orion crew module. So this is one of the most complex parts that we make, and one of the most complex parts on the rocket. So here we're taking a 12,000 pound plate. It's 6-inch thick aluminum. We are forming it as a raw plate, and 5 to 6 months later, after a series of machining and forming and aging, you get the part that you see there on the lower left, which weighs roughly 290 pounds. And what's cool about this is that's actually the windows that astronauts will look out when they're floating around space. So that's exciting for us. Here's an example of some of the tooling and ground support equipment that we manufacture. So we were fortunate to partner with Boeing on the 787, and we made a series of wing tools to help them join the wings to the fuselage and then join the wing tips to the wings. So we designed and built these tools at our facility in South Almani and shipped them up to Everett. Here's some more example of our tooling projects. So we have the Joint Strike Fighter bond tools made out of Invar. We have the 787 lower wing skins, and then we have some mill fixture tooling that we use for the Orion crew capsule. So in April of last year, we became the first company since the Space Shuttle era to receive the NASA's Space Flight Awareness Award. So that was a big honor for us. Additionally, thank you. Additionally, we were recognized by the NASA Marshall Space Flight Center last year as a Small Business Subcontractor Excellence Award. And the LA Times came out to our facility here in El Monte and did an article on us last May. So one of the topics of our panel was a challenge that we face and how we overcome it. And I think that Kellie touched on this a little bit, but this is not something that's unique to AMRO, but to our industry, is the cyclical, programmatic, and what we call boom or bust nature of our business. So when things are good, they're you know, usually really good, and you have all the work you can handle. When they're not good, then it makes things tough. So we talk a lot in our shop about culture. So over the years, we have developed a culture of human spaceflight hardware. And we believe that when we work on projects like Orion and SLS, it raises our shop to a level where we feel like we can really go and chase markets. So if spaceflight, which fortunately it looks like it does not going down anytime in the near future, but if spaceflight were to make a drop, we feel confident that with the level of our personnel and the level of that we have brought our training and our processes, that we could go chase after, you know, building work stands for military aircraft or go make parts for commercial aircraft because we have the experience of working with, you know, what we feel is the ultimate in manufacturing as far as putting humans into space. One of the keys to that is the communication and awareness that we build with our workforce. And our cross-training programs. So we invest a lot of time and effort into cross-training our employees over multiple skill sets. So, you know, we can take a guy from machining a piece of hardware that's going to go into space, and then he can then go and run a machine that could make a widget for a work stand. Another thing is we try to communicate to our workforce and make sure that they are kept up to date with the business climate and what is coming up and some of our challenges and our opportunities ahead and try to really get a buy-in from our guys and from our men and women, I should say. One of the things that Camille touched on was the mentor protege. So we were honored to be selected as a mentor protege company with Boeing back in 2014. So this has been a really important relationship for us overall for our company. So basically, we were given the opportunity to work with some of the cream of the crop of the Boeing personnel across the board. So we participated in several 5S and Lean training courses, and we've implemented those across our shop floor. We have developed sets of metrics to gauge our performance, and that's something that, you know, the mentor protege team and our team worked extensively on, and we feel that is also useful in helping us navigate through both boom and bust climates. We went through extensive FOD training and refined our processes to control our FOD, and also went through extensive program management best practice scenarios with the mentor protege team, and that really helped raise our level and gave us the opportunity to better serve our customers. Finally, we have embraced the role of becoming our own worst critic. So I like to tell the story of a part. We, in addition to the parts that you see there, we also make the hatch for the launch abort system. This is the hatch. The launch abort system is basically the cap on top of the SLS. And if something happens at any point during launch, it'll safely take the crew away from the accident. So this hatch is very complex, and it has over 1,500 holes in it. And our team spent over a week preparing these holes and tapping these holes and installing inserts. And one of our guys, toward the last day, we had like 10 holes left. He grabbed the wrong tap and he messed up two of the holes. So we were, you know, we were all freaking out, and it was beating ourselves up for, you know, the whole day and preparing this documentation. We don't know what we're going to tell our customer and the engineering team. And So finally, I pick up the phone, I make the call, and the engineer says, "Well, heck, Mike, there was 1,500 holes. I'm surprised you didn't screw up more of them." the point of the story is not that it's okay to make mistakes. The point of the story is that we have a level of expectation that, you know, that we make perfect parts every time, and everyone in this room knows that that doesn't happen in a manufacturing environment. So we embrace the role of, you know, being our own worst critic and expecting not perfection, but a very high level of performance. So, want to thank you again for having us today and AMP SoCal, and we look forward to growing our relationship moving forward. So, thank you guys.
Now it's my pleasure to introduce to you Shawn Webb. He's the Director of Operations for AeroVironment. Mr. Webb has a long legacy in history and operations in aerospace industries, and I'd like to share that one thing that really stood out to me is he has over 20 years of successful manufacturing leadership with a focus on revitalizing organizational performance in leadership positions and leading from the front with an orientation toward tangible, measurable results. So I think you're starting to see a theme here across our panelists about some of the things that they need to implement to help them continue to grow and continually be successful. Shawn?
All right, so a little overview of who AeroVironment is. A lot of people haven't heard of us. I wanted to say we do really cool stuff, and we're able to do about everything we try to do. But marketing got a hold of the presentation and added some slides and it's true, we provide customers with more actionable intelligence so they can proceed with certainty. That's most of our products, what they do. AeroVironment's a technology innovator in multiple industries and various applications. You'll see kind of the company split in a minute, but we kind of have two areas that we focus: energy efficient systems, so it's electrical chargers, charging equipment for forklifts, things like that, cars, Volvo, Nissan Leaf, et cetera. And then the larger part of the business is the unmanned aircraft systems. Really, we started in 1971, I think it was, with a very small company, grew out of a garage and achieved some exploding growth, and have done quite a few things over those years, from human flight, solar-powered flight, achieved highest altitude records with a solar aircraft, unmanned aircraft, of course. We started in the game several years ago, to lately a munition or a missile that I'll talk about. We target global long-term trends with innovative new solutions, often being a disruptor to the market. Often we'll come up with a product that our customers say, "I have to have that. I don't know how I'm going to implement it." So it's those kind of things that we target and go after. We are the most prolific supplier of small unmanned aircraft systems to the DoD. One product, the Raven product, we've sold over 40,000 units. So that's why you can see is our as far as our company revenue, it's the largest portion of what we do, and we've seen continued growth over the years. And of all aircraft, unmanned aircraft in the Department of Defense inventory, we're 86% of that as far as total units. Now, they're much smaller than some of the unmanned air vehicles that you see on the news. Ours are man-packable, hand-launched in many cases, and or rail-launched in a couple cases. Our energy-efficient systems, talked about that a little bit. It's really charging solutions and even battery cyclers for the battery labs that auto manufacturers will put in place so they can test their batteries before they come out to production with them. So when we talk about we were asked to present something that was a problem that we had to overcome. AeroVironment's a very innovative company, some really talented engineers that seen some explosive growth with unmanned aircraft systems and suddenly had to figure out how to make more than one, right? And that happened, and we delivered several thousand, as you said. Now we're in a similar position with a new product that we have. It's a loitering munition and has the ability to wave off in case it's not the correct target. And our customers are really finding, hey, this is interesting. I want some of these, even variants of it, different payloads, different sizes, launched from different platforms, whether it be ground, air, or underwater. And so we're seeing a lot of interest in that area and need to grow, and we see a great business opportunity. But we're not a company that's built missiles before, right? It's completely different. It's really a change in culture. Some of the approaches, and I left the kind of the key slide out at the end here, I'll talk about, but you know, the approach was, hey, get a dedicated team of some of our key people. We pulled key people off of key projects to put on this and implement a world-class manufacturing site to meet the customer's needs. We also invested in different testing methods to provide the highest confidence for our product. Perform a gap analysis, so a real deep look internally. Well, where are we missing? What do we need to add? And develop those mitigation steps to compensate for that. And then implemented process control plans, added requirements for traceability, engineering skill sets. Assess our supply chain. The UAV supply chain is a little bit different than what's required for missile requirements. And then a three-year manufacturing world-class best practices implementation plan with phases across those years. And then put a factory in place. The key, and unfortunately I left the slide out, but the key to that is that's a cultural change. That's a mindset and behavior change. And we have a great set of employees. We have this attitude that we can do anything, and we typically have done anything that we put our mind to. But they don't have the experiences. They haven't done this before. So how do you change the culture to get it to a point where, stop doing the cool innovation stuff for a minute, or do that in a different area, and now we're gonna build a bunch of product. And for us, I picked an influence model that really has four puzzle pieces that come together to make that happen. The first one is, identifying what is the compelling story to get people bought in and engaged into it, right? For us, it's we have this business stream, we have this opportunity, we have interest, and implementing world-class best practices. Then the next thing is, okay, a compelling story. You need to reinforce that continually to keep it going, right? So reinforcement mechanisms. So we implemented key performance indicators, floating it down to the lowest levels. Visual performance, so you can talk about your performance issues, get it out on the table so everybody can see it. And so the team, what we're guiding for is self-directed teams, so they have the information they need so they can manage themselves proactively. And then, decision boards to make sure your resources are focused on the right things. You have a compelling story, you have a reinforcement mechanism to keep it going. You need skill sets. Third piece of the puzzle was skill sets. So we had to do a gap analysis to say what skill sets are you missing, and you either have to hire those or partner with people that have those core competencies that you don't have, one of the key things we did. And then additionally, training, job skill training, continuous improvement training, Six Sigma and Lean, leadership training was important as we formed integrated product teams Well, what does the integrated product team do, and what is the leadership supposed to do for those? So now we have a compelling story, reinforcement mechanisms, and skill sets. The last piece is what a lot of people in this room can do, is role modeling. And so I heard it earlier, management by walking around is one key aspect. I live and die by that. It's walking the walk rather than just talking the talk, and really demonstrating that by holding people accountable to what you said we're going to do, by actually following the best practices, and by demonstrating that you're behind it 100% at all levels of the management team. And once you have those, we found once you have those four things, you're able to start adjusting the mindsets, the culture to change to where you need it to be for that team. And that's my last slide. Thank
you. And now I'd like to introduce to you Scott Wallace. Mr. Wallace is the Executive Vice President of Engineered Solutions for Votaw Precision Technologies. He is also a former president, and I think it's outstanding to note that during his 10 years presidency, the company grew their sales from $14 million to $50 million. It's quite a feat. Scott?
Hi, so it starts with Petraeus and ends with me, so I don't think you could get a further gap, but let's see, where's this? So I'm going to go through this real quick. We are in Santa Fe Springs. We have 225 people, about 225,000 square feet. So we're a precision machine shop that does, you notice all the subtract or additive manufacturing people have all gone home because they only work half days. We are all subtractive manufacturing people. We're still here working, so. But we can do it all. We've got laser tracker, CMM, Romer arms. This is the parts of the current SLS Orion vehicle that we're on and the things that we build for them. Up in the upper left-hand corner is the barrel. That's where the astronauts will actually sit inside that. And it starts as 18,000 pounds, and we ship it at 900 pounds. So try to make that additive manufacturing, right, guys? So tough stuff, very, very difficult stuff. You cannot be wrong. You have to make that right. You get one shot. And every day, that's the reason I look the way I do, is you cannot go to bed at night knowing that that machine is running 24/7. And anyway, we do it right. So this is another part that's part of the abort system for the abort system. And then some other pieces. This goes on the solid rocket boosters that are similar to shuttle going SLS. They all had to be remade. Those are very difficult. Criticality one parts. Our machinists have been awarded Silver Snoopy Awards from NASA, which is the highest award they give to a person directly on the floor. It's kind of humbling to see. I think I've got a picture. Let me keep going. I'll come back to that. These are some incredibly difficult parts for Boeing. On the left side, that's where the astronauts are going to crawl into their CST-100 vehicle. And to the right there is up at the space station right now, and that's part of the capturing feature that's up there. You see this 20-foot diameter turning that we have at Votaw, the back truss assembly that we've built. This is a 72-foot long by 17-foot mandrel that makes the payload fairing for the Delta IV Boeing vehicle. So if you can try to print one of those, I'll tell you. So just a huge tool that Boeing uses a lot to make what they need, so for the Delta IV. So this is kind of the, in closing here, the part that really set us up in the industry. Back after Challenger, we got a call from NASA and Thiokol saying, hey, we need to remachine the grooves in the solid boosters. So I was a part of the team that made the pitch to NASA that we could do it. That required us taking a 15-foot tall, 12-foot diameter cylinder to rerounding it to within 2/1000ths of an inch and to cutting 3 to 5 thousandths off of those areas. We did that for 120 parts, defect-free, and that man that's at the top of that there got a Silver Snoopy Award for that. So it's kind of cool to bring people back to space. So that's us, so thank you.
So I think we have time for a few questions. I'd just like to sum up a little bit before we move on. I think what you've seen here, and I know you're all happy that you stayed, was really a theme of innovation and adaptability to emerging markets, but also complexities that come along with some of those emerging markets. You saw the ability to strategically adapt and envision what the future is going to look like. And then these leaders put in place strategies so that they could propel their companies going forward and make them successful. I would also like to thank our panelists for making your company stronger, to be a great part of the Boeing supply chain, as well as the industrial supply chain, and improving products for our warfighter, our astronauts in space, and also for all of us who fly on those aircraft each and every day. So thank you for that.
Libby Williams, AMP SoCal. One of the things we as a partnership, as support organizations, find very difficult is how to reach you guys, supplier chain. And we find it very difficult, and I understand for a number of reasons, because you're busy running your operations. But our goal is to help support and provide you with services and to find out what you need so we can see collectively how can we respond and put something together. Can you share with us, in your opinion, what's the best way to reach out to your colleagues and your peers? Because we're finding it, there are thousands of suppliers within Southern California. Honestly, this room should have been filled with nothing but suppliers based on the number of them that we have here in order to try to help provide them with services and help and assistance, but it's difficult to get to you guys. And I'm just wondering, how is the best way, in your opinion, to reach you and your peers?
I have a thought. What I would like to see is that, you know, other states keep their work in their state. I don't know how this affects you folks, but if I go to Texas to sell that capability, they go away. We keep that in Texas. California never says that. A lot of the primes send their work out of California. I would like them to keep it in California. There is nobody like the aerospace business like we have it here, but I'm telling you, there is things happening now to some of our subs vendors, right?
Yep.
Processing houses, they're getting closed. And if that keeps happening, we have got a major problem. So I think I'd like the primes to get together and kind of strategize and keep the business here. We can do it, but we need your help to do that. I don't think it answered your question, but I had to throw that out there.
It's true. I mean, smaller companies, we're very agile, flexible, move fast, and lean, right? It's busy, busy, busy. Even to come to something like this is, you have to ask yourself, is this going to be worth it, right? And it is interesting because I kind of was accidentally invited through a relationship with someone else. Mm-hmm. I had never heard of it before. I don't know what the answer is. It's not an email, I can tell you that.
Absolutely.
And phone calls to people like me are difficult. It's got to be some more events like this, but somehow get the advertisement of it out there. More, I think these are great events. I learned something from them, but I don't go to many because I'm busy. I'm not sure which ones to go to. Some way of getting the information out there in a way that grabs my attention in 10 seconds, but lets me know it's important. And I really don't have the answer, but.
I do want to reiterate a thank you, though, because we understand you taking time out of your work day to come here. We really do appreciate it. We really do.
Thanks for showing up, guys. As a small job shop owner, Votaw and AMRO, I want to ask you how you finance your projects and how you manage risk.
We asked Boeing to help us.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Progress payments, there has to be. For the material, they pay for the material up front. And then as we continue these big projects, we can't finance them all the way. So we ask for payments along the way. How do you manage risk? That's we're still alive.
Okay.
I mean,
meaning that if, somebody tapped a hole wrong last out of 1,500, there goes, 6 months worth of work. What are you going to do? How do you explain risk to you?
These businesses are extremely risky. Every day they're bidding right now as I speak, and right, all of us are. every job could be a winner or a loser. It takes people like us in the room to make sure that the risk is assessed. It is a hard life. I mean, every day it's pull.
Yeah, I would say that's where the training and the process control really come into play. So if, you know, we know that like Scott said, there's always going to be risk, but we know from a production risk, we know we can manage that by having processes in place, having highly trained, highly skilled employees, and making sure that, you know, we're doing everything we can to limit those types of mistakes.
I think also we've paid some tuition, each one of us here, on specific problems in the past. We never repeat them. And knowing that, when you sit down in a room and you bring 30, 40 years of experience, it saves a lot of problems that we don't repeat the same thing again. And that's why we're still here.
I was just going to say that I think manufacturing is probably in all of our DNA. And, you know, manufacturers are tough, they're resilient, they're driven to succeed. And I think the best way to manage risk is exactly what you were saying regarding having really detailed procedures, having a highly skilled workforce, you know, and being able to really follow that and monitor it. And there's always going to be risk that just comes with the job.
I was just at an Aerospace Industries Association meeting earlier this week. In fact, I flew here from Seattle last night, and much of the talk around risk really focused from this business is full of high risk and low reward. And so you have to make it work for you. It's entrepreneurial, it's moving into disruptive technologies, and seeking partnerships to help mitigate some of those risks. I will say, I'll give the Boeing company a plug at this point, but we pay all of our small businesses who are working on government programs at 15 days. So that helps with your cash flow and helps keep the, you know, net 30, net 90 day going.
Going back to the risk issue, you know, I've been a government guy my whole career, and the old adage was, you know, the Boeing folks operate on a cash contract. You folks, then they pass on to you fixed price contracts. The cash flow issue is one thing. The risk mitigation in a fixed price contract is yet another thing. Is that true? Are all of the kinds of things that you folks show us fixed price?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yes.
Yes.
And most of our contracts are fixed price now also.
No, they're not. Not for SLS. They're cost contracts with incentives.
But that changed. 30 years ago, we cost projects actually reached down into small companies. And they were cost plus. I remember them well.
Sure.
Didn't have no idea how good we had it back then. If those were the good old days,
but,
right?
But you folks can't complain. You know, you can't. The mouth that feeds you, the hand that feeds you, you can't
well,
complain.
Well, that stopped a long time ago. For us, for all of us.
If I know there are some other of your colleagues and peers who are in the room who wanted to speak to you guys up at the front, if you've got a few minutes, you can wait afterwards and just say a few words or pass a business card along. We'd really appreciate for some in the room. I just did want to ask that before you got off. But otherwise, thank you all, and thank you so much, Camille.
Thank you.